Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In alhamdulillah, nahmadahu ta'ala, wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh, wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina, wa min sayyi'ati a'malina, ma yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah, وما يدلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم على عبدك ورسولك نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعه بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما واصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما. Indeed and verily, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the best of thanks and the praises He deserves, testifying that there is none worthy of being worshipped in truth besides Him alone without any partners. Further, testifying that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His slave and His messenger. We beseech Him by His beautiful names and His excellent and lofty attributes to send His peace and blessings upon Him, His family, all of His companions, and whosoever follows His direction, His sunnah, His ways, until the establishment of the last hour. As the brothers and sisters were informed, by Allah's fadl, virtues upon us, we begin a new lesson tonight in this month, after a blessed month, the month of Shawwal, which comes after the month of Ramadan, with the six fundamental principles, Al-Usool Al-Sitta, Al-Shaykh Muhammed Ibn Abdul-Wahaab rahimahullah ta'ala. And as the brothers and sisters in this community, we mentioned before his biography shortly. He is known as a mujaddid, a reviver, in a time when the people, they began to fall into polytheism, to shirk. His father was a qadi, a judge, and he came from a very eminent family. He memorized the Quran at a very young age. And also his father encouraged him to get married at an early age to save his son from the evils of the society and from falling into major sins. Likewise, he set out at a very young age seeking beneficial knowledge, knowledge of the religion of Al-Islam, wherein he excelled. And he became famous amongst his teachers at an early age because of his concern for the preservation of Tawheed. In a time when fiqh was predominant, in an era where fiqh was the main focus, so Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala raised his status amongst his teachers. And then after ascertaining a good amount of understanding and ilm, he returned to his town Uyayna, where he began to invite the people to Tawheed and to warn them about the polytheism that they fell into. And because of this, he became an enemy. Because of his call to Tawheed and his call to the upright way, the upright religion, he became an enemy to his own people who plotted against him and attempted to assassinate him, which caused the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala to flee from his own town and to go to other places. And then he came upon the leader of the Muslim land in that time, who gave him safety and allowed him to establish his call. And so the call of Tawheed, it was reborn. And then shirk began to face its opposition, the Book of Allah and the Sunnah. So for this reason, he was known as a Mujaddid, a reviver. And he is the Shaykh Muhammed Ibn Abdul-Wahaab rahimahullah ta'ala, who was the author of this book and other tremendous books, treaties, that call the people to the upright religion. And I always remember our father and teacher Shaykh Saleh Al-Fowzan mentioning that if you look into the books of Shaykh Muhammad Ibn Abdul-Wahaab, even though the people, they hate him with an extreme hatred, everything that he calls to is based on evidences from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So even after his death, we find that the people, they are enemies to his da'wah and to his call, which is the da'wah and the call of the Quran and the Sunnah. So we enter into this beautiful book or treaty, the six fundamental principles. And the scholars, they mention, if it is that an individual, a believer, has a good understanding of these principles, then he has a very good understanding of his religion, a very good foundation in his religion. So without any further delay, we go into the book. And we're going to focus on the introduction in our opening lesson. So the Shaykh Al-Mujaddid Muhammad ibn Abdul-Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala, he began by saying, من أعجب الأجاب وأكبر الآية الدالة على قدرة الملك الغلاب. He said, from the most amazing affairs and from the greatest signs which point to the strength or the power of the king, and he is no other than Allah, which point to his power and that he is the victorious, meaning that Allah, he overcomes. Sitta to usul bayanahu Allah ta'ala bayanan wadiha lil'awami fawqa ma yadhunnu adh-dhanun, are six principles. Six fundamental principles which this book is based upon. And as we mentioned before, and the scholars, they directed us, it is six principles which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clarified in his book. He has clarified in his book, as is mentioned here in the introduction, in a clear manner that even the regular folk can understand. And then he said, beyond what the suspicious ones may perceive. Then he said, ثم بعد هذا غلط فيها كثير من أذكياء العالم وأقلاء بني آدم إلا أقل القليل. So after this clarification, meaning the clarification of what? These six principles. Many of the so-called intelligent ones of the world, and also the intellectual ones from Bani Adam, they fell into mistakes, or they erred with regards to these principles. And then he said, "Illa aqall al-qalil," except for a very few people. Except for a very few people. So this here is the text for the introduction of Al-Usool Al-Sitta. And this is what we're going to focus on, as we mentioned before. And we're going to read from the sharh of Shaykh Saleh Al-Fowzan Hafidhahullah Ta'ala. And where needed, we will explain to the brothers matters that may not seem clear as we go along. So pay extremely close attention. And Alhamdulillah, I must say, may Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala reward all of you. It brings great joy to see so many youths, so many young ones present in our sitting, present in the sittings of knowledge. And as we mentioned before, there is no doubt that you are the ones that are going to carry this flag. You are the ones that are going to be the du'ats to call us to Tawheed and Sunnah. So for any teacher, this is something that brings great joy. To see that the youth, they have an interest and a love to be in the sittings of knowledge. Before revising for tonight's lesson, I was reading from the treaty of Sheikh Abdul Razak al-Badr Hafidhahullah Ta'ala. Wasaya al-Salaf lil-Shabab. The advices of the Salaf to the youth. And while reading it, wallahi, I was tempted to surprise the brothers tonight by reading some passages from it as the introduction. But I decided that we're going to do this in another sitting with the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before moving on, we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to make our sitting a sitting of sincerity, seeking only His good pleasure in His face, seeking only to see His face, His beautiful face, which will only be reserved for the people of Iman. So our Shaykh Saleh Al-Fawzan Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, in explaining the introduction, he began with his praises of Allah and beseeching Him to send His peace and blessings upon His Prophet Muhammad, his family, and all of his companions. And then he said, لا شك أن الله سبحانه أنزل القرآن بيانا لكل شيء. There is no doubt that Allah subhanahu sent down the Quran to clarify every single thing. Allah sent down the Quran to clarify every single thing. As Allah, He said in His book, إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم. And indeed, this Quran, it directs to the uppermost way. So this book, the Quran, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala revealed it to clarify all matters. وأن رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بيّن هذا القرآن بيانا شافيا. And likewise, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarified this Quran with a complete clarification, description, examples. And then he said, وَعَذَمُ مَا بَيَّنَهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُ فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ قَدِيَةُ التَّوْحِيدُ وَالشِّرْكُ لِأَنَّ التَّوْحِيدُ هُوَ أَسْلُ الْإِسْلَامُ وَأَسْلُ الدِّينِ. And the greatest of that which Allah and His Messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, clarify in the Quran is the matter of Tawheed and Shirk. Is the matter of Tawheed and Shirk. No matter what the people say, those people who get upset when they hear about the works of Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul-Wahaab, or Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, or Shaykh Ahmad ibn Hanbal, or Imam Malik, or Imam al-Shafi'i, and all of the great scholars of the past, Imam al-Dhahabi, Abu Hanifa, clarifying the matters of Tawheed and Shirk, it gets them angry. But the reason that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala revealed His book, and the reason that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, His Sunnah, it is wahyi, it is to clarify these matters. It is to clarify the matters of Tawheed and Shirk. And that is because Tawheed, it is the foundation of Islam. And it is the foundation of the religion. وَهُوَ الَّذِي تُبْنَ عَلَيْهِ جَمِيعُ الْأَعْمَالِ. And Tawheed is that which all of the actions are built upon. وَالشِّرْكُ يُبْتِلُ هَذَا الْأَصْلَ وَيُصِدُ. And know that shirk, or polytheism, it is that which falsifies or corrupts the matters of Tawheed. وَلَا يَكُونُ لَهُ وُجُودٌ. And when shirk becomes predominant, it seems as though the Tawheed is not present. Just like we just mentioned, in the time of Shaykh Muhammed Ibn Abdul-Wahaab, the matters that were clarified and taught were the matters of fiqh. And the people, they used to be upon grave worship and the likes. And this was something that could not settle in the chest of the Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala. That he used to even question his teachers concerning these matters. So when it is that polytheism or shirk becomes rampant, or it becomes the main thing, then what does it do? It makes it seem as though the Tawheed is not present. Then he said, لِأَنَّهُمَا أَمْرَانِ مُتَضَادَّانِ وَمُتَنَاقِضَانِ لا تجتمعان أبدا. Allahu Akbar. He said, because these two matters, Tawheed and Shirk, what do? They contradict each other. And they oppose each other. And never do these two matters come together. Never do they come together. Tawheed and Shirk are two opposites. They are enemies to each other. They are like water and oil. It can never be mixed together. He said, فَلِذَٰلِكَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ بَيَّنَ هَذَا الْأَصْلَ فِي كِتَابِ فِي جَمِيعِ الْقُرْآنِ. So for this reason, Allah the Mighty and the Magnificent, He clarified this principle in His book. In all of the Quran. Allah, for this reason, He clarified this principle. Which principle? Tawheed and Shirk. In His book, في جميع القرآن. In all of the Quran. Pay attention. We just left the month of the Quran. Pay extremely close attention. فلا تكاد تخلو سورة من ذكر التوحيد وذكر الشرك. Therefore, there is no chapter in the Quran which is void of mentioning the matters of Tawheed and Shirk. No chapter in the Quran which is void of mentioning the affairs of Tawheed and Shirk. Test it for yourselves. Look at Surah Al-Fatiha. We know the Tawheed ينقسم إلى ثلاثة أقسام. The Tawheed, it is categorized into three categories. Tawheed al-Rububiyya, Tawheed al-Ibada, or Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, and Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat. طيب, let's just pick out one chapter in the Quran. Let's look at the mother of the Quran. The initial beginning of the Quran. The opening of the Quran. Surah Al-Fatiha. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praises are for Allah, the Lord of Alameen, the Lord of Jinn and mankind. This is which category of Tawheed? Rububiyyah. Then Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says next, huh? What's next? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. What category of Tawheed is this? Al-Asma wa Sifat. Maliki Yawmiddin, which category? Master of the Day of Judgment. Maliki Yawmiddin, Ar-Rububiyyah. He is the master. He is the king of the day, which is known as Deen. Not the Deen of Al-Islam. Yawmuddin is another name for Yawmul Qiyamah. What comes next? Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. You alone do we worship, and you alone do we seek aid or help. Which category is this? Ayu qasam? Tawheed al-ibadah. Aw al-uluhiyyah. The opening chapter of the Quran. All of it is Tawheed. So the Shaykh Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, he said, and there is no chapter in the Quran that is void of mentioning the matter of Tawheed and Shirk. Every messenger, this was their call. U'budullah, worship Allah. U'budullah, wa la tushriku bihi shay'a. Worship Allah and do not commit shirk. Every messenger came with this call. Then the Shaykh, he said, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, wa nasu yaqra'una hadha al-Quran wa yuraddiduna. And the people, they recite this Quran. Not only do they recite it, but they recite it repetitively. They do it all of the time. He said, وَلَكِنْ قَلَّ مَنْ يَتَنَبَّهُ لِهَذَا الْبَيَانِ. But you find that few of them take heed with this clarification here. They don't take heed. Very few. وَلِذَٰلِكَ تَجِدُ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ يَقْرَؤُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَيَقَعُونَ فِي الشِّرْكِ وَيُخِلُّونَ بِالتَّوْحِيدِ. For that reason, you find that most of the people who recite the Quran, they fall into the matters of shirk. And you find with them, that the matters of tawheed are void. Subhanallah al-Azim. Take a look around. So many people, they memorize the Quran. So many schools, right here in Buffalo, memorizing the Quran, reciting the Quran. But almost everyone in this little city right here don't understand the matters of Tawheed and Shirk. And this is what the Shaykh is telling us in his explanation. That the people, they recite the Quran and they fall into Shirk. And you find that their lives are void of Tawheed. مَا أَنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ وَاضِحٌ في كتاب الله وفي سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأنهم يمشون على الأوائد وما وجدوا عليه آباءهم وما شايخهم. He said, but all of this, you find that this matter, it is clear. Which matter? Arkam. Which matter is clear? In Allah's book? Allahu Akbar, Tawheed and Shirk. He said, with all of this, you find that this matter, it is clear in the book of Allah. And it is clear in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But why do they fall into shirk? And why do they not understand the matters of tawheed? He said, that is because they tread upon the old ways of what they found their forefathers upon. What they found their fathers and forefathers to be upon. What they found their mashayikh, their teachers to be upon. He said, فَالْأَصْلُ عِنَّهُمْ مَا وَجَدُوا عَلَيْهِ آبَاعَهُمْ وَمَشَايِخَهُمْ وَأَهْلَ بَلَدِهِمْ وَلَا يُفَكِّرُونَ فِي يَوْمٍ مِنَ الْأَيَّامِ أَنْ يَتَأَمَّلُوا وَيَتَدَبَّرُوا الْقُرْآنَ وَيَعْرِضُوا عَلَيْهِ مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ النَّاسِ هَلْ هُوَ صَحِيحٌ أَوْ غَيْرُ صَحِيحٍ. He said that you find that the foundation with them, you know, look, take a good look, O young ones. Look at the aqa'id. Look at the ways of the people. The ways of the people, those people who are adamant to be upon the schools of thought. And they don't understand why we have schools of thought. That it is only in the matters of fiqh. And it is not in the matters of creed and belief. Not in the matters of tawheed. But the people are so ignorant of the matters of deen that they hold on to what? To the schools of thought. They blind follow it. So take a good look around and you will find so much enmity because of this. Because of not understanding the religion. Not understanding the matters of tawheed and shirk. So you find that the foundation with them. And when you ask them, as you see here, when you ask them why, they say, well, this is what my father taught me. This is what my grandfather taught. My grandfather, my great-grandfather was an imam. This is what our people were upon. This is the foundation that is with them. And also because of what the people in the country, and also because of what the people in their country or their city are upon. The majority of the people. Then the Shaykh, he said something that is astonishing. And he said that you do not find them contemplating for a day from the days, considering at any point to contemplate or reflect upon the Quran. And after reflecting upon the Quran, that they take whatever they found in the Quran, after reflecting on the verses and the ayat, that they take what they found in the Quran and that they put it against the people. To see what the people are doing and what the Quran is telling us. And then they ask themselves, after looking at the actions of the people, هل هو صحيح أو غير صحيح? Are the actions of the people correct? Or is it not correct? And the reason that he's telling us is so that we can contemplate. The reason that the ulama are explaining these things is so that we can contemplate on these matters. That we can reflect on these matters. So this is something that you need to do. You need to look and see at the actions of the people. The young men like you. Lots of young men in the city of Buffalo. Memorizing the Quran. In the Quranic schools that are here. Hold them into a conversation. And ask them concerning the matters of Tawheed and Shirk. If you didn't do this already. Did any one of you did this? And what was the response? How was the interaction? Amazing, right? Astonishing, right? That people are memorizing the book that clarifies Tawheed and Shirk. But they don't know. What is Tawheed and Shirk? And this is why there are matters that are going to be clarified. So pay extremely close attention. He said, بَلْ أَخَذَهُمُ التَّقْلِيدُ الْأَعْمَى لِأَبَائِهِمْ وَأَجْدَادِهِمْ. He said, rather, that which has seized them is blind following. Blind following their forefathers, their fathers. He said, وَاَعْتَبَرُوا أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ إِنَّمَا يَقْرَأُوا لِلْبَرَكَةِ وَحُصُولِ الْأَجْرِ وَبِالتِّلَاوَةِ. اللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ. He said, they hold that the Qur'an, it is merely recited for blessings. It is merely recited for blessings. Or to receive the reward for its recitation. وليس المقصود أنه يقرأ لتدبر والعمل بما فيه. And they do not deem that the intent for reciting the Quran is to contemplate upon it and to act upon that which is found in it. Allahu Akbar. Whenever you have conversations with them and you memorize ayat that point out the matters of tawheed and shirk and you explain it to them, look at the response, at how they behave. How they look at the people of Tawheed, the people of Sunnah and clarity with scorn. As though what is being told to them is something that is non-existent. As though what is being told to them is something that is strange. And so they treat the people who remind them of Tawheed and Shirk as strangers. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Al-Islam bada'a ghareeb, Al-Islam bada'a ghareeba, wa ya'ooda ghareeba, fatuba lil-ghuraba, or kama qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Islam began as something strange. And what was prevalent when Islam began? Shirk. So when revelation came, it began as something strange. When the people were worshipping the idols in the Kaaba, from every corner, the people that would come there to do their trading from every other land, they will travel through the desert, and they will come in the vicinity of the Kaaba, and they will trade, and they will circumambulate in worship. Worship of what? Worshipping of the idols that were there. Then the call to Tawheed came. And the people, what did they do? They scorned this call. And they scorned the caller to this call, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they do not see that the Quran is recited to contemplate upon it and to act upon it. قَلَّ مِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ لِهَذَا الْغَرَدِ. He said, very few of the people recite the Quran with this goal. Even for the people of the Sunnah, and the Quran is not just merely to be memorized. But the greater intent of the Quran is to act upon it, to understand it. Whatever you memorize from the Quran, then have a good understanding of it. Understand what are we being called to. What are we being warned from? What is the invitation here? What is upon me? What is upon my wife, my children, my community? How do I trade? How do I deal with my children? How do I deal with my mother, my father? Every single thing is found in the Quran. Everything is found there. So the Quran wasn't given to the people to just, like any book you pick up, and you see, if you look into the academic world, and as many of you go to the university here and the schools here, they teach you how to skim through a book. You have a word, correct me if I'm wrong, that is called skimming. Is it not so? What is the meaning of skimming? Skimming through something doesn't give you the complete meaning of what is in that passage or what is being meant in that writing. It is just to give you an outer picture, and most of the times it is wrong. So the Quran is not that we just memorize it and we recite it, but the goal of the Quran and the purpose that it was sent was to direct the people. هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. It is huda, it is guidance for mankind. And a clarification of guidance, and a furqan, a criteria. Why did Allah say this? That it is بَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ, a clarification of huda and furqan. Contemplate, O young ones, contemplate. Why did Allah say that? It is a clarification of guidance, wal furqan, and it is a criteria. Criteria from what? What is it a criteria for? For human beings, that they may do what is correct. They may follow the commands in there, so that they can purify their hearts. This is the reason that the Quran was revealed. He said, وَإِنَّمَا يَقْرَؤُونَ لِتَبَرُّكِ بِهِ أَوْ أَتَلَذُّذِ بِسَوْتِ الْقَارِ. And you find that they recite the Quran to receive blessings by it, and also to find the sweetness in the voice of the reciters, وَتَرَنُّمِ بِهِ, and to find the melodious tones, أَوْ لِكِرَاءَتِهِ عَلَى الْمَرْضَى لِلْإِعْلَاجِ. SubhanAllah. He said, even you find that they recite the Quran upon the sick people in order to bring cure to them. Subhanallah al-Azim. All of these things, the people, they use the Quran for, except understanding that it was sent to help the people. أَمَّا أَنْ يَقْرَأُوا لِلْعَمَلِ بِهِ وَتَدَبُّرِ وَصُدُورِ عَمَّا فِيهِ وَأَرْضِ مَا عَلَيْهِ النَّاسِ عَلَى هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ فَهَذَا لَا يُوجَدُ إِلَّا فِي قَلِيلٍ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. He said, as for reciting the Quran to act upon it and to contemplate and ponder or reflect upon it and to compare it with regards to what the people are truly upon as it relates to this Quran, that this is something that is not found except in a very few from amongst the people. And then the Shaykh, he clarified, he said, لا نقول إنه معدوم. We do not say that this is non-existent, that the people, they don't do this, meaning that they recite the Quran to reflect upon it. لكنه في أقل القليل. However, this is the minority. This is the minority. ولذلك تجد القرآن في واد وأعمال بعض الناس في واد آخر لا يفكرون في تغيير أبدا. For this reason, you find that the Quran is in one valley, and that the actions of some of the people are in a totally separate valley, and that the people don't ever think about making changes in their lives. He said, وَلَوْ حَاوَلَ مُجَدِّدٌ أَوْ دَاعٍ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْ يُغَيِّرَ مَا هُمْ عَلَيْهِ لَقَامُوا فِي وَجْهِ. And if it is that a mujaddid, a reviver, or a caller to Allah wants to help change what the people are upon, to show them the way, you find that they would stand in his face. How true is this? How many people are calling to Tawheed and Sunnah? Honestly, brothers, honestly, pay attention to me. Honestly, I don't see most of the brothers for Jumu'ah. Oh, I see you sometimes, not most of the times. You go other places for Jumu'ah sometimes. True or false? How many times have you heard the call of Tawheed? Be honest with yourselves. I'm not asking you with doubts. I know what I'm saying. The scholars know what they're saying. Be honest. How many times? Tawheed and shirk. Now I ask you a question. You look at the condition of the people. Are you with me? You look at the condition of the people. In your humble estimation as young men, do you believe that these people need to learn anything else at this point of their Islam and their lives other than this matter? Yes or no? Understand something, right? We just said that every chapter of the Quran, if you read it, you find the matters of Tawheed and Shirk. True or false? So which means it is what? Repetitive, right? Can we become fed up of it? Can we say, why only Tawheed, Tawheed and Shirk, Tawheed and Shirk, Tawheed and Shirk? Huh? Only Tawheed, only Tawheed. So subhanAllah, the Quran is only Tawheed and Shirk. This is the goal of the Quran. As when, alhamdulillah, when Allah blessed us to open this masjid, the youth, they came to me. They were trying to give da'wah and put invitations to the classes, and there were people that were rebelling. That's like here. The call to Tawheed and Shirk, the brothers, they came back to me and they said, let me guess what the call is to. The call is to Tawheed, right? The call is to away from shirk, right? Am I right or wrong? Yes or no? This happened to you guys. You told me that you put it up in the group and someone came out, a couple people, they came out and they did what? They stood up. They don't want this call. Oh, let me guess. What is the class about? Muhammad Ibn Abdul-Wahaab, right? Huh? What is the class about Tawheed and Shirk, right? So what should it be upon? This is what we were created for. وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ And I have not created the jinn and the humankind إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Except that they worship me. What is the meaning of يَعْبُدُونَ? Huh? أَيُّوَحِدُونَ Meaning that they single me out in worship. Huh? So you find the Quran in one valley. And the understanding of the people in another valley, lost. And if it is that someone comes to revive or call the people to Tawheed and to Islam and to help them to come out from what they are upon, what do? They stand up in his face. You know, sadly, honestly speaking, this is a sad matter. Even people who claim to be upon Tawheed, they chose to be enemies to their brothers upon Tawheed. Just for one thing, calling to the truth. Then the Shaykh, he said, وَالتَّهَمُّ بِالدَّلَالِ And they accused this individual of being upon misguidance. وَالتَّهَمُّهُ بِالْخُرُوجِ عَلَى الدِّينِ وَأَنَّهُ أَتَى بِالدِّينٍ جَدِيدٍ وَأَنَّهُ And he is accused of exiting the religion of Al-Islam. Yani they pronounce upon him kufr. And he's accused of coming with a new religion. And that he is this and he is that. How prevalent is this? True or false? He said, كَمَا حَصَلَ لِهَذَا الشَّيْخ نَفْسَهِ لَمَّا حَاوَلَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ أَنْ يَرُدَّ النَّاسِ إِلَى الْقُرْآنِ وَمَا دَلَّ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنِ وَيُغَيِّرَ مَا هُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْعَادَاتِ والتكاليد الباد he said ويغير ما هم عليه من العادات والتكاليد الباطلة he said just like the Shaykh was upon Shaykh Muhammed Ibn Abdul-Wahaab he established this that he tried may Allah be pleased with him to return the people to the Quran and to what is found in the Quran to the evidences in the Quran and to help them change from their customs And from blind following falsehood. Who was he? Who was Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab up against? Huh? Polytheists only? Was Islam extinct? They were claiming to be Muslims. People who claimed to be upon Islam and worship. So the Muslims, the majority of the Muslims, they need to understand the matters of Tawheed and Shirk. And it is a matter that is not left. He said, Tharu fi wajhi wa badda'uhu wa fasaqu. He said they retaliated in his face. And they accused him of innovation and sin. Bal wa kaffaruhu wa tahammuhu bi ittihamatin walakin fil haqiqa هذا لا يضر وليس بغريب. He said, rather they declared him to be a disbeliever. And they falsely accused him. But in reality, this doesn't cause harm. لا يضر, there is no harm. And this isn't something that is strange. Pay attention, eh? فإن الأنبياء قيل فيهم ما هو أشد من ذلك. But rather, as it relates to the prophets, what was said against them was more severe than this. He said, لَمَّا أَرَادُوا أَن يُغَيِّرُوا مَا عَلَيْهِ الْأُمَمْ مِنْ إِبَادَاتِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ قِيلَ فِي حَقِّ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ مَا قِيلَ He said, when it is that the prophets, they did what? They wanted to help change the people. And those nations that came before, they wanted to help them with regards to their worship, that they were worshipping other than Allah. However, that which was said against them was severe. They said what they said against the prophets. How many examples can we think of? Every single prophet. Which prophet, which caller to Allah did not face this? O young ones, if you want to be du'at, if you want to be students of knowledge, if you want to follow these footsteps, this example here, then you have to understand this matter. It's not a path of bed and roses. It's a path that has adha, hardships. Tayyib, look at the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Khalilullah, a ummah. He was referred to as an ummah by himself. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala informed us that he said to his father, Ya abati, la ta'bud ash-shaytan. Ya abati, la ta'bud ash-shaytan. Inna ash-shaytana kana lirrahmani usiyya. He said, Ya abati, la ta'bud ash-shaytan. Inna ash-shaytana kana lirrahmani usiyya. O my father, do not worship the shaytan. What is the call away from here? Shirk. Oh my father, Ya Abati, do not worship the shaitan. Indeed, the shaitan is a persistent rebel. Ya Abati, Inni akhafu an yamassaka azabun min ar-Rahman fatakuna lishaytani waliyya. Look at these beautiful words. Look at these beautiful words that is found in Surah Maryam. He said, Oh my father, indeed I fear that the punishment of Ar-Rahman is going to seize you and that you are going to become a companion of the shaitan. Look at the father, what he said to him. He said, قَالَ أَرَاغِبٌ أَنْتَ أَنْ آلِهَةِ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمِ لَإِنْ لَمْ تَنْتَهِي لَأَرْجُمَنَّكَ وَهْجُرْنِي مَلِيَّ. He said, O Ibrahim, have you turned away from my gods? Yani, this is a father and a son. A father and a son. The son is calling his father away from the worship of idols. And he's calling his father with the most beautiful exhortation and reminders. Don't worship the shaitan. Don't worship the shaitan. The shaitan is a rebel to Allah. Oh my father, I am fearful that the punishment of Ar-Rahman is going to seize you. And do not be a companion of the shaitan. What the father says to him. He says, Oh Ibrahim, have you turned away from my gods? Ar-Raghibun anta an alihati ya Ibrahim. La'in lam tantahi la'arjumannak wahjurni maliyya. If you do not give this up, if you do not stop what? What did he want him to stop doing? What did the father want Ibrahim alayhi salam to stop doing? Stop Tawheed. Don't call the people away. Don't tell me about this. Stop this call. Straight up he said, if you don't give this up, give it up right now. Like they said to the Messenger of Allah. They went to Abu Talib. They said what? Go to your nephew. Tell him to stop this call. Stop this call. We'll give him. We'll give. If he wants money, we'll give him wealth. If he wants woman, we'll marry him to the best of our woman. If he wants to be the one that is in charge, we make him the leader of all of the tribes. Just tell him to stop. So Ibrahim's father, he said, if you don't give this up, I will stone you to death. A father telling his son that for what? A father becoming the enemy of his own child for the matters of Tawheed. So what can be said for the regular people? If you don't give this up, I'm going to stone you to death. And then he says to him, very mean, think about this. I want you to just go away from me forever. Go from me, get away forever. Imagine a father is telling a child this. What is the child doing? Something wrong? He's calling to the truth. He's calling to what his Lord commanded him to call and invite to. And the father is threatening him with death. And his father is disavowing and detaching ties of the womb with his own son. قال سلام عليك سأستغفر لك ربي إنه كان بي حفيا. He said, peace be unto you, I am going to seek the forgiveness of my Lord for you, and indeed my Lord, he is always kind to me. So this isn't something that is strange. Whoever takes this path, then this was the path of the prophets and the messengers. Then the Shaykh, he said, فَلَا غَرَبَةَ فِي هَذَا. There is no strangeness in this. وَهَذَا لَا يُنْقِصُ مِنْ أَجْرِ الْعَالِمِ وَدَعِيَ. This does not decrease the reward of the alim and the one that is inviting to Allah. بَلْ هَذَا يَزِيدُ فِي حَسَنَاتِ إِنْدَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَلَى. But rather, when he establishes this call, and he goes through the struggles of calling to Tawheed and warning against shirk, then his blessings are going to increase with Allah. وَإِنَّمَا يَرَجِعُ بِالنَّقْصِ عَلَى مَنْ قَالَهُ وَمَنْ تَفَوَّهَ بِهِ وَكَتَبَ فَإِنَّ هَذَا يَرْجِعُ عَلَيْهِ. He said, but in reality, the deficiency or the blunder returns to the one who speaks and writes against the one that is calling to the truth. Yani whatever he's accusing him of, then this comes back to the one that is making the accusation. What time is the adhan? Okay. As for the ulama that are sincere and the callers to Allah, then there is no harm upon them based on what the people are saying with regards to their call and with regards to what they're doing. But rather, when they stick to the matters of Tawheed and Shirk, their levels are raised and their blessings are multiplied. And they have for themselves قُدْوَةٌ بِالْأَنْبِيَاء, as an example, the prophets. And what was said against the prophets, and that the prophets themselves, they were wrongfully accused. Yani, look at the situation carefully. We know the Messenger of Allah, was he free from people calling him names? Liar. They called him a liar. They call him a soothsayer. They call him a magician. Huh? From the one that was known as Al-Amin, the trustworthy. And he was As-Sadiq al-Masduq. He was the most truthful individual. And yet they fabricated lies and they called him so many names. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says concerning his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا يُقَالُ لَكَ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ كِيلَ لِلرُّسُلُ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَذُو مَغْفِرَةٍ وَذُو عِقَابٍ عَلِيمٍ. That nothing is said about you, O Muhammad, except that it was said concerning those messengers that came before you. Isa alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, we just read, Musa alayhi salam, all of them, Nuh alayhi salam, calling to Tawheed and the people fabricating lies against them. Indeed, your Lord is the owner of forgiveness and also the owner of painful chastisement. He said, therefore the Shaykh, may Allah have mercy upon him, in these words, clarify something that is astonishing. He says that the people, they recite the Quran, and they are much in its recitation, and they complete the Quran, and they memorize it, and they recite it in the most beautiful of voices, and they are yurakizun, they concentrate with regards to the alfaz of the Quran, wa tajweedihi wa ahkam al-mad, and all of the legislations of the Quran, mukharij and tajweed, they concentrate, they give great concentration to these things, the letters and the likes, and I'm going to skip yani the ahkam al-idgham wal-ghunnati wal-iqlab, all of these are the rules of tajweed. Then he says, wa ya'tanuna bihadha inayatan fa'iqatan. He said, they place an astonishing amount of care in concerning this. وَهَذَا شَيْءٌ طَيِّبٌ. This is something that is good. وَلَكِنْ الْأَهَمْ وَالْمَقْصُودُ لَيْسَ هَذَا. But the matter that is important and the intent is not this matter. And I want the brothers that come to this masjid to contemplate. Lots of brothers, they want to come and memorize the Quran. And they give a lot of, and this is good. Not true? What I'm speaking, is it not the truth? They give a lot of concentration. They want to, you see the class. The brothers is to come, they come, they come, they come. Alhamdulillah, they come to this, these classes as well. But sadly and regretfully, not as much as they give concentration to just wanting to recite the Quran. And again, this is good. But the goal should be understanding the Quran. This is not the goal, just to recite and learn the ahkam and to memorize and to recite with a beautiful voice. He said, Al-Maqsood Tadabbarul Ma'ani. The intent is to contemplate on the meanings. Wa tafaqquhu fi kitabil 'azza wa jal. And to contemplate on the book of Allah, the mighty and the magnificent. Wa ardu a'malina wa a'malin nas ala kitabillah. Hal hiya muwafiqatun li kitabillah aw mukhalifa. And that it should be the Quran, it should be something by which we look at our deeds and we look at the actions of the people and we try to see if it is that these actions are in accordance to the book of Allah or if it is in opposition. هذا هو المطلوب. This is what is needed. أن نصحح أوضاعنا وأن ننبه على الأخطاء وأن ننبه على أخطاء الناس لا بقصد التشهير وقصد النيل من الناس بل بقصد الإصلاح والنصيحة. He said, that which is needed is that we advise ourselves, we advise our own souls, our own bodies, and that we point out and help the people with regards to their mistakes. Not with the intention of slandering or belittling the people, but with the intention of rectification and giving nasiha. And this is the end of the introduction and the end of our first class.